thank you. As Ross said, my name is Gil Blander, and I'm founder and chief scientific officer of Cyctera. And I will tell you today a story about myself, why I started this company, and what have I done, and what was the result of the experiment. So, like most of you assume, I would like to live longer, be healthier, and improve my performance. And I actually started this journey long ago, and I decided to focus on studying aging, and I did it in the last 20 years. And here you can see a few more examples of what I wanted to do. And basically, after a few years in the academia, I realized that it's a bit boring, and I decided to move to the industry and try to find how can I extend the lifespan, not by doing a labs experiment, but basically by doing a real study and helping people to live longer and better. So basically, I decided to try to find a way to understand what happened in my body and understand what happened in your bodies. So what I've done, I tried to look for a tool, but I couldn't find any tool. So I spent the last 3 years building such a tool, and I tested it on myself, and I will show you what happened. So basically, I looked at 10 basic markers, as you can see here, and you can see that surprisingly, half of them were wrong. So half of them were in the green zone, but half of them were either in the red zone or the orange zone. And you can see that the markers are normal markers. Some of them are more common, like glucose and cholesterol. Some of them are more bizarre, like creatine kinase, which is a marker of muscle degradation that occur usually when you exercise too much. And here you can see an example of the range that that I developed, that basically, instead of having a pass-fail, like when you go to the diagnostic company, you have a range that is specific for you, and we develop it based on a diagnostic, on a big database of 80,000 people, but also extracting a lot of information from the literature. So basically, I can say that my range is here, and actually I'm there for the cholesterol, so something is wrong about me. So we developed this tool, and now the question is, okay, so I have high cholesterol, so what does it mean? Am I going to die tomorrow? What will happen with me? So we thought about a lot about that, and we decided that, first of all, we need to understand what are the implications. So here you can see the second part of the tool that basically give you the analysis, explain to you what are the implications if you have high cholesterol or you have a low vitamin D and so on and so forth. And what is cool about it that when you click here, you go to the scientific literature and that show you exactly what the scientists that did the experiment saying. And in addition, you get some recommendations. So basic recommendations like a few food that you can eat, and also some other recommendation that give you a specific information, what should you do in order to basically, in this case, decrease the level of cholesterol. So that's basically this part of the tool, but in addition, we saw that it's very important to focus on food, because food is what we were born to do, and we need to eat food instead of taking a lot of drug like liver, for example. So basically, we develop a list of food that you should eat either more or less. In this case, we have high cholesterol. 20 food items that you should eat less in order to decrease the cholesterol. And in the case of vitamin D, 20 food items that you should eat more. And not surprisingly, you can see a lot of fish here. And if you look at the bottom, you will see one mushroom. But that's basically what you can eat in order to increase your vitamin D. And in addition, we develop another tool that basically give you a whole solution that solve all the issue at once. So basically, you have a daily menu that can solve the issue of, in this case, cholesterol and vitamin D, and give you less a lower amount than the RDA for vitamin D, higher for vitamin D and lower for cholesterol. So that's the short discussion about the tool, and now I will discuss what happened with me. So as I showed you before, I had around 5 markers that were out of range. Before that, you have some way to customize it, so you can come and say that you are eating vegan food, or you want to eat low lactose, and so on and so forth, and you will get the food menu customized for you. And you can also say that you like apple and papaya, and if it's good for you, the algorithm will give it to you. If it's not good for you, you won't get it. So, sorry about that. No bacon. Anyway. So what have I done? So I decided for all those battery of 100 of recommendation to do the following. I ate more fish, more vitamin D, more this bizarre kind of mushroom that apparently have a lot of vitamin D. I drank more fortified milk and oranges because it's also have a lot of vitamin D. And I ate less of the good stuff that apparently not good for me. I took a vitamin D supplement at the days that I haven't ate enough fish, because after a while you cannot eat fish anymore. And lifestyle changes, so I ran less and alternated with cycling, because I had some knee issues. And from doing the research, I realized that if you alternate your exercise, you can improve that. And when I exercise, I tend to add a strength and flexibility to the endurance, because again, I realized that can help me with the knee. Some more thing for having more vitamin D, like spending 20 minutes a day under the sun. I also did some stuff for sleeping better, so I stopped exercising 3 hours before bedtime. I watched comedy before bedtime. I did some more yoga. I stopped watching the evening news. And I stopped working on my computer 2 hours before bedtime. And I recommend everyone to do that. Anyway, so I was pretty successful with vitamin D. I had 19 on April, and I bumped it up to 41 in October, and that's good. I was much less successful with cholesterol. So I had 214 on April, and basically left it at the same level on October. And some side effect, because I haven't focused on that, the calcium somehow went up. The folic acid stayed the same, and the hemoglobin more or less stayed the same. I understood what is the problem with my cholesterol, because in the second time I looked also on LDL, HDL, and triglyceride, and I understood that the problem is LDL. So now I'm trying to work on the LDL, and that's hopefully will help you with also with the cholesterol. So to summarize, so first of all, I become more health conscious, and now I understand what should I do, and I understand the machine that calling me better than I knew before, and I think that that's very important, because before that I didn't know what to do, and now I'm much more know what to do. I had a knee problem that I solved, and it's great, because I couldn't run in the last couple of years, and now I'm running twice a week, and then cycling the other twice. And the last one, I improved the quality of my sleep by just doing those small changes that I described to you, some comedy, no evening news, and other stuff, and I'm sleeping much better. So that's all. Thank you.
Dave, I'm going to start with my own question.
Sure.
You made so many changes to your diet and lifestyle. How do you know which ones are responsible for the impact that you
have? It's an excellent question, and I don't think that I will know. Also, doing an experiment of N of one, it's hard to know. So it's an excellent question, and I think that all our life, even if the guy that spoke about the Fitbit, which is a great tool, there are so much influence around it. So you did it in the summer, in the winter, and it's very hard to come and pinpoint and say that because of increasing my vitamin D, I have less problems with my knee. I don't know.
When you pick your normative ranges, you're using some kind of opinion database where you're talking to experts about it and you're getting opinions about what's safe and what's not safe. How do you handle findings that point to the issue of, let's say, cholesterols of 220, 240 protecting people against Alzheimer's disease, where other risks may be lower, other risks are higher in different ranges? How do you handle that? And the second thing is, how do you handle people, for example, like me, who, when I eat 3 eggs a day, my cholesterol goes down to 160, and when I don't eat any eggs, it goes up to 220.
Lucky you. But it's a good question. So first of all, we are not dealing with someone that is sick. So that's the goal of this company is taking someone that is healthy, like hopefully all of you, and take you to your optimal zones. Basically make you healthier, and hopefully you will have to go to the physician less, and you will live longer, hopefully. I don't know if it will happen, but hopefully. Now, in addition, when we do this test, we have a physician that reviews all the tests, and if someone have a range that is critically too high or too low, we basically ask him, this customer, to go to his physician to do PCP and deal with that before we are releasing the result.
Yes, I want to stay on that theme for a minute, because I feel like this is a great sort of learning moment, and just point out something that I saw in your talk, which is that you measured some things about yourself. You had an elaborate sort of recommendation tool, like this is what you should do based on expert advice, and then you got results. Your results were positive, but they weren't related to your recommendations. So, for instance, your vitamin D went up, you took vitamin D supplements, your knee problems improved, and your sleep got better due to your behavioral changes. But that everything that came out of your recommendation engine, which in terms of your diet aimed at your cholesterol, failed. So, my question to you is, this seems great. I mean, this seems like exactly an ideal procedure. You made a tool, you did something that toolmakers who come sometimes and get toolmaker tots never do, which is so frustrating. You tried the tool on yourself. You proved that your tool does not work the way you thought it would work. The recommendations did not work for you. So my question for you is, since that's great, that's a wonderful talk in a sense, what are you going to do to change your tool, given that you learned through your own self-experiment that it didn't work for you?
So first of all, allow me to disagree with you that the tool didn't work.
Just the recommendation, I mean the expert component. The dietary choice component that was designed to lower your cholesterol did not.
Oh, okay. No, that's an excellent point.
Yeah.
So to reduce cholesterol is very tough. It's much easier to take a marker like a vitamin D, for example, that is low, and shoot it up. Take supplement and you will shoot it up. Actually, we did a pilot with 50 people, and what we found was astonishing, that 50% of those 50 people ate too much with a lot of stuff, because we are, as Americans, we tend to eat a lot and to take a lot of supplements. So it's very hard to shoot stuff up, but it's much harder to shoot stuff down, because what you need to do is to eat less of a high cholesterol, and sometimes you have a genetic issue that makes you very hard to take it up. So I agree that half of it work, but to take cholesterol down, it's not easy, and it's also take much longer. To increase the vitamin D might take a few months. To decrease the cholesterol, it's a struggle. That you can take a Lipitor and maybe it will help you, but I'm trying to do it without it.
But are you rejecting, that's okay, but I just want to know, are you rejecting the evidence from your own end of one trial about your recommendation engine, or are you accepting the evidence, or are you considering that evidence irrelevant? What is your attitude towards your own experiment that you've done here on your own tool?
Okay, so as to the cholesterol, when you eat a fatty fish that basically have high cholesterol, they have a lot of fat and a lot of cholesterol. So that's one reason why my cholesterol level went down. That's one point. The second point, as I said, to decrease the level of cholesterol is a lifetime effect. And especially when you play, you have multivariant system. I had five different markers that weren't being in the right range. What we are seeing with other customers, that some of the markers went up, but the other went to the other direction. So suddenly you had a bad cholesterol, you correct the cholesterol, the glucose will go up. So it's basically a struggle that is a lifelong struggle. You need to start playing with, it's like juggling like five balls in the air. So I completely disagree with you that the experiment was failed. What I'm saying that it's a lifelong a struggle that I will need to do a lot of follow-up and start to pinpoint, and hopefully all of them will go to the green zone. I'm not sure that I will succeed to bring all of them to the green zone, but hopefully all of them won't be in the red zone.
One of the things that I love most about the question and answer session is that it becomes a group think exercise. And I think one of the points that Gary brings up is that when we do tests on ourselves, it's very hard to step back and say, what are my underlying assumptions here? And are those underlying assumptions, how do we test them moving forward to see if they're correct? And that can be really hard as somebody who does a lot of experimentation on themselves, especially with something with diet. But I would propose that perhaps your underlying assumption that dietary fat equals more cholesterol is wrong. And so looking at your diet and, you know, taking out some of the whole grains and the juices and that sort of thing, and upping your fat would be an interesting next step for your cholesterol study.
Okay.
Can we take one more question?
Yeah.
So I also dispute two of your underlying foundations. One is you say the medical system is not geared toward keeping people healthy. And I think that's wrong. There's a lot of doctors you go in to see, and they spend an enormous amount of time on preventive medicine. So how old are you, by the way?
How old am I?
Yeah.
41.
41, okay. Well, you know, when you hit 50, you need a colonoscopy. All that is demonstrated to extend life. So one thing you didn't, so the other assumption I question is that blood tells the whole story. I saw no mention of blood pressure, and that is probably the single number that determines the race extent, your lifespan. And you can't get that from measuring stuff in the blood. So if you want to live a long time, get your blood pressure down, and then worry about the other stuff. And there's no mention of smoking. Of course, you have to stop that too, if you're a smoker. So this strikes me as peculiarly narrow and naive in terms of trying to achieve your goal of living longer.
It's an excellent point, and we are integrating the smoking and the blood pressure in the questionnaire that we are asking. And now, you need to start somewhere. So we can come to with an approach to measure 500 markers, and it will be very expensive and also available only available for a few people, or come and look at a 10 to 15 markers that we researched in the last 3 years and found out that 95% of the population of the American population will have at least one or two of them out of range.
But that's a statistical anomaly.
So why don't we stop it for now so we can get to the next speaker? But I would like to emphasize that part of what we have found over the years in all of these quantified self experiments and people trying different things is that many of us are not willing to simply accept the statements of the medical profession about what is known and what is not. And even while we disagree, some of us, with what Gil has done, we're thrilled that people are trying these things and are trying to investigate things and are trying to put things out there that we can all learn from.